and make sure that you reach the safe assembly point. In case of any unwellness or any discomfort during the session, please reach out to our team and we will have a medical team on standby who will take care of you. Kindly request you to put off your cell phones on silent mode. When they sneeze, it's a cause of concern. When our children fall sick, we all worry. When they play in the rain, we run behind them to wipe them dry. Our children become the number one priority for all of us, and caring their health is the most important responsibility of parents. The shield that protects them from falling sick is their immune system, and it's a complex mechanism that is vital for their health and health. And today we will be discussing few of its dimensions to help in caring our children better. Now, I would like to invite Ms. Aishwarya to address the welcome.
Good morning, all of you. Thank you so much for taking time out of your precious Sunday and sharing it with us today. Let me welcome you to our fifth edition of PEP Talks, Patient Education Programs by Anand Lab and Newberg Diagnostics. We started this about a few months back. We've completed two in Chennai and about the third one in Bangalore. The previous editions, we've covered topics like breast cancer, diabetes, women talk, and all of that. We started this initiative to spread awareness about a particular topic, particular disease or ailment, and get you the relevant information required to catch the symptoms early, so that you can take an informed decision on your diagnosis and your subsequent treatment along with your doctor. So today's topic, we are obviously covering a very popular topic among the children, exams. No, we are covering immunity and allergy. As you all know, I'm sure this doesn't come to you as a surprise. In India, one of the biggest problems that we face is most of the diseases and ailments are not diagnosed soon enough. We wait, we delay, we put things off for another day. And therefore, obviously, we hamper the effectivity of the treatment, isn't it? So one of the biggest reasons we've started this PEP talk is to make sure and make all of you understand the importance of early diagnosis. So please join me in helping spread the campaign message, which is act now. The best protection is early detection. On that note, please allow me to welcome Dr. Balachandra. I'm sure most of you know him. He's a well-known pediatrician and allergist in Bangalore. Thank you so much for being with us today, Doctor. We also have with us Dr. Samrat and Dr. Pradeep, our very own in-house pathologist, autoimmunity and allergy, and of course, hematopathology. Thank you so much, all of you, to be there with us. Brita, can we welcome Dr. Balachandra? Alright, so Doctor, over on to you to take over the session. Thank you so much. I hope this session helps you, and as I say in all my PEP talks, awareness and knowledge is one thing, of course, but please remember, taking action on it and acting on it is of paramount importance. So we really, really hope this is effective, and as you can feel, summer is already here, isn't it? And with summer here, the incidences of allergy is rising, the incidence of immunity dropping is coming up. So we really, really hope that this talk will help you understand and manage this condition better. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. At the onset, I would like to thank Anand Diagnostics to call me. And I'm really surprised to see a huge crowd here on a Sunday. Usually Sunday is the day we all wake up very late. Maybe there's no breakfast, there's only directly brunch or lunch. So good to see so many people. So before I go ahead, I myself have little viral infections, cold cough. So my immunity is on a little lower side today. So I've been asked to talk on allergies in childhood. So I'm comfortable not on talking myself I'll be more glad to have an interactions. I'll be comfortable answering the questions, because whatever I have prepared might suit one person, but there are like 20-30 people here who have their own individual needs. They would like to know, they have come with a purpose that I have this problem or my child has this problem. Okay, let me discuss it out in a forum. So I'll be more comfortable discussing individual questions and anything. You can stop me at any point of time. And Malayalam is a little difficult, but other than that, all South Indian languages I can speak. Kannada, Tamil, Telugu, Hindi, English. You can ask me in any language, I can speak in any language. It doesn't have to be an official. Please consider it as an unofficial, you're talking to your friend or your colleague. Okay? Okay. So, now what does this basic allergy mean? So, there's a different perspective with each and every person. Is it like I don't like a person and I'm allergic to him? Just for fun? Okay, and wife can tell I don't like my husband. He's irritating me. I'm allergic to him. Okay? Or somebody can tell I don't like your in-laws. Like, I'm allergic. So is it that meaning? I don't like eating brinjal. I don't like them. Is it that is the meaning of an allergy? But no, I don't like cold weather. Wherever I go cold weather, I get cold and cough and fever. So I'm allergic to the cold weather. Is that the meaning? I don't give ice cream to my child. My child has not had ice cream for the last 3-4 years because he's allergic to the ice cream. Or I sneeze a lot when I get exposed to the dust. I'm allergic to the dust. I get a rashes after eating milk, so I am allergic to milk. Which among this is true, or all of them are true?
Dust.
Okay, the fifth one is true. Last one is true. So the top four are not true. Okay, then let me tell you my experience. In my clinic, in my practice, I work in Manipal, I have my own allergy center. On an average, I see around about 50 patients per day, plus minus. But most of my patients come with these things. I'm sad to hear that some of my patients have not had ice cream for the last 4-5 years. I'm very sad to hear that. As a child, if you don't eat, then when are you going to eat? Not at my age, I'm worried about my health, my weight, my diabetic or anything. Thankfully, I'm not. So, if a child you don't eat, then when do you eat? If your child is avoiding milk, curds, butter, bananas, fruits, vegetables, then when are you going to eat? I'm surprised to say that most of the hospitals in front of them, they have a fruit shop. But all my parents will come and tell, this fruit will cause this, this fruit will cause this, this fruit will cause this. So why is that belief is different from the reality? Or is there a connection which we are missing it out? So let's look into that. Now, there are different types of allergy. Okay? So, there is a skin allergy, food allergy, dust allergy or sneezing what is called, or eye allergy, asthma, and say medicine allergy or drug allergy. There are so many other varieties. I have not covered too much because it's not possible to discuss everything. So today I am going to discuss the most common ones. So I am going to give a scenario, or I am going to talk about few words about that. But whenever you feel relevant, you want to ask me questions, you please ask. So now, how common is allergy? Is it a rare problem? Is it like everyone have allergy? One out of one? One out of three? 1 out of 5 or 1 out of 10? How common is it? It's just a perception, it doesn't have to be accurate.
1 out of 10.
1 out of 10, okay. The reality is 1 out of 3. Not only in our country, in fact in our country allergies are growing in a rapid phase. Last 20-30 years the allergies were like minimal, maybe 1 out of 10, but now it is 1 out of 5, 1 out of 3. In a clinic when I see, I'm not talking about one allergy, it can be any of the allergies. It can be a dust allergy, it can be an asthma, it can be a food allergy, it can be a skin allergy or anything. So 30% of our population have one or other allergy at some point of their lifetime. As a childhood, as an adulthood, it is different. This is something which is like, even in here sitting here, every other person, a third person might have an allergy. Now, I'll start with the common topic, that is, allergic rhinitis. That means that it is a nose allergy. Okay, that means that particular person will have frequent nose leak, and it can be discharge of any color, nose block, or you might be having noisy breathing in the night, snoring. Sneezes. Every day morning when they wake up, they can start sneezing it. Or some people when they go outside, some people when they get exposed to the dust. Itching. Okay? Nose itching, I mean to say, not a skin itching. I feel like irritating, and you see many children are doing this. That is to kind of get the comfort of itching. Some people make same brings sounds in the throat like that. You know, I can't do that. So they keep on repeating those sounds. The high redness or high itching. So usually these symptoms when are there, mostly the person is having a nose allergy. Whether it is short duration, long duration, again the history will tell that. Now, is this something which is bothersome? Is this something which we can let go? Okay, it is there, so what? Is it important to consider it, even treat it also? The importance is not those symptoms alone, but the effect of those allergy in the child's life, or even adults for that matter. They get very frequent cold and cough. When a child comes to clinic every month or every 15 days, believe me, when I see a patient and he keeps coming to me every 15 days, the first thing is, I feel bad. Something I'm missing it out. I'm not doing a good job. Okay, why is my patient coming frequently? I'm okay to see the patient once in 2-3 months, but why am I seeing him every 15 days? I'm missing it out. Okay? Most of the times when they have frequent cold and cough, the presumption is, my child's immunity has gone down. So give me something so that his immunity goes up. Okay? But that may not be true. Actually, the child's immunity is perfectly normal. But there is other conditions which makes him more prone, more easily catch up the cold and cough. Sleep disturbances and snoring. Most of the allergic children or adults, they don't sleep well. Though they sleep for 10-12 hours, but the quality of sleep, the deep sleep is never there. And these children, on the next day, either they have a behavioral issues, or they sleep in the school, or they have learning disabilities, and they don't perform well in their school or sports. This is something which is not acceptable for a child. Lack of concentration, school absenteeism, frequent cold cough allergy, not attending school, recurrent ear infections. Okay, at least once in 2-3 months have a ear pain. Recurrent sinus problem, behavioral issues, and even this, all these things will even for an adult can have motor vehicle accidents because the sleep quality is not good. So the allergy per se might not be bothering much, but the effect of the allergy is causing significant disturbances. Now, these are some immediate problems of nose allergy. What are the delayed problems, psychological problems? A long-term nose allergy results in lack poor quality of sleep, behavioral issues. Asthma, almost like 2/3 of allergic rhinitis will end up with asthma. Even with treatment also they end up with asthma. Because it is a nose allergy, when it goes to the chest allergy, that's what is called asthma. Okay, it is just a matter of time. They start having this allergic shiners, that is below the eye, this marks on the nose, the lines. This marks are something which is very difficult to get rid of. Earring loss. They end up with recurrent hearing loss and end up, again, hearing loss will more worsen the learning disabilities. So this is something more than the nose allergy, the effect of nose allergy on the child, day-to-day life, on the child, on the school performance, on the parents, makes a lot of difference to control that and if possibly, identify and cure it. Okay, now I'll talk about the chest allergy. So this chest allergy, especially in children, they come with frequent cold cough. Most of them we see they have a nebulizer at home or they get nebulized frequently. Every month or every alternate month, and most of them they get tired going to for nebulization, they keep it at home and they start using it frequently. So this frequent cough, especially more in the night. A child who's coughing predominantly in the night, midnight and early morning hours, that's something a character of a chest allergy. No noisy breathing from the chest. It can be nose block or it can be wheezing also. Cough or breathlessness with activity. Cough, whenever the child runs or climbs one or two floors, they start coughing or breathless. cough while laughing or crying, and family history of allergy. This information is enough to tell that, okay, this child is different. This child's cold and cough is not a regular cold and cough. This is something different. Okay, I don't need to address the presently why they have come for. I need to address why they are coming to me more frequently. If I see last 4 or 5 months or 6 months, if they come to me like 5 or 6 times with these frequent symptoms, then doing a 4 or 5 days of treatment and then sending them home is only expecting them another 15 days later, unless I solve the root cause. So with this
family history you mentioned over just now.
Yes.
Is it, you're talking about, is it hereditary or something like that?
Hereditary. Hereditary. If father, mother, grandparents, anybody has got like dust allergy, sneezing, skin allergy, food allergy, that makes it more possibility. The research tells us if one parent has got an allergy, that will say nose allergy or dust allergy or anything, the chances that the child becoming an asthmatic is around 40%. If both parents have got an allergy, the chances of becoming an allergy, the child having allergy is 70-75%. Even the grandparents having an allergy, that can percolate in the child. Because this allergies and asthmas are all mostly, I mean to say 80% of it is a gene mediated disorders. So they do end up with that. Okay, now briefly talking about the nose allergy and the chest allergy. I'm not going too deep into each subject because it's too much to cover. When we talk about allergy and allergy treatment, we generally talk about the 6 important aspects. Now, medical therapy, when we give medicine, which forms only a part of it, it doesn't become the whole part of it. It only is a small part of it. So, education, unless the family, child, parent, person who is suffering from allergy, he understands what is he going through, why is he going through, what could be done to reduce it, okay, and what is that? See, any long-term disease, if the patient is not in understanding with the doctor, that can never be treated. Say, diabetic for that matter. No matter what best medicine the doctor gives, but the patient is not understanding and not following the do's and don'ts, it's waste of everybody's time and money. Say, like blood pressure. Similarly, allergies and asthmas are long term. Do not expect that relief in 1 week or 10 days, 15 days. And for long term disease, the knowledge education is more important than the medicine alone. Second comes avoidance. When we talk of avoidance, usually what is mostly followed is blanket avoidance. Don't eat curds, don't eat milk, don't eat fruits, don't eat banana, don't go to the cold weather, always cover yourself. It's like, one day is fine, 2 days fine, then what about the life? Keep we doing that every day in and day out is... And again, when we see that, are you following all these things? Yes, I am following all these things, but still my child has got a cold and cough. Why? The reason is you are shooting in the dark. So close your eyes and shoot. You may hit it, you may not hit it. But rather avoidance has to be specific. An example, one person might be allergic to the grass pollen. Another person might be allergic to the dust mite. Another person might be allergic to the dog dander. Another person might be allergic to banana. So why is it that everybody should follow a simple same rule? You are allergic to penicillin, please you don't take it. The world can take it. But sadly what happens is everybody starts avoiding blanket whatever somebody else tells him. This is where the quality of life goes down. So avoidance is necessary, that is perfectly after identifying what allergy you are going through. Not blindly because I feel it or neighbor feels it or my doctor tells it. I have to need a proof, evidence that I am allergic to this. I will avoid this, I will overcome like this, and rest of it I will enjoy my life. Nutrition plays an important role. Overweight, underweight, still overweight makes it very worse for allergies. Vitamin D has got a significant role. There is a lot of studies to say allergies and vitamin D are connected. We talk about medical therapy, we give our medicines and we make sure that the patient's condition is good because that is something which works immediately. Why the patient has come to me for the relief. So I have to give that relief to the patient. But most of the times medical therapy works as long as you are taking it. the moment you stop a few days or weeks or months together, back, again you are back. You are again back to the same symptom. There is another methods also. So, yes, but that therapy is needed for relief of immediate relief. We also train our patients, especially on asthma, with an emergency therapy. That's because we want to reduce a lot of medical visits. A little cold, little cough, a little wheezing, why should that patient rush back to the doctor? We train them, okay, this is how you manage. 80% of the medical visits can be cut down. This is a step two. If it is worsening, this is what you need to do. This is a step three. When things are worsening, you should rush to the hospital. So that reduces medical visits significantly. Certain non-medical therapies, exercise. Exercise is something which definitely benefits the nose allergy as well as chest allergy. Any form of exercise. If possible, breathing exercise like pranayama or swimming is very good, but also any form of exercise, consistently minimum 5 days a week of 1 hour of activity. Generally, when I tell this, my patients tell, my child plays, doctor. But structured physical activity is something different from playing. We also teach them about Jalneti. The last one is allergy vaccination or immunotherapy. Most of the patients would come asking, can you give something long-lasting relief? Is there a cure for this? Okay. Then we say, I can't tell you cure, but there is something nearer to the cure. When we identify the allergy, usually the dust mite or certain pollens, there is an immunotherapy which has shown excellent results. Even extend that, 75 to 80% of them have been able to stop their nasal sprays, able to stop their inhalation medicines, sprays, everything, and been able to do well for 15 years after stopping the therapy also. But that only works only if the patient is allergic to dust mites, pollens, certain pollens, okay, not for all. So this is something which is brief what we do, okay. So we'll come back to this and revisit this. Now, coming back to the point, like I was telling, that blanket avoidance never works. But avoiding blanketly everything doesn't work. It has to be specific. So when it comes to identification, find out the root cause. Okay? Helps us to plan our future course of disease and management and for immunotherapy. Without identifying what allergy you cannot specifically avoid, you can't plan for immunotherapy. So now, when we do an allergy test, what we generally include is, what I'm talking here is mostly for the nose allergy and the chest allergy. I have not yet come to food allergy. Okay, please don't confuse. And when we are doing this nose allergy and chest allergy, generally we don't include food as a testing part only. The reason is, food allergy rarely causes cold, sneezing or wheezing. So rare that testing is itself is a waste of money. Okay, nose allergy, chest allergy is caused by something which we breathe. Sadly, we can't see them. Dust mites are like 6 microns, which is present in everybody's house, in their bed, in their pillow. My house, your house, including President of India's house. Everybody's bed have got dust mites. There is a study which says that per square feet of bed in Bangalore, I've got 1,200 mites. So we are all living with that. The food of the dust mites is human skin, the top layer of human skin, which it feeds on it and releases its fecal particles, releases its dander, its saliva. They are around 1 to 2 microns. When we sleep, we actually are breathing those things. Everybody, an allergic person, non-allergic person. But a non-allergic person, because his immune system is in friendly response with the dust mite dander. But an allergic person, his DNA, his immune system is different. Many people say that immune system is low in allergic person. Actually, that is wrong. An allergic person have got a normal, good, protective immune system, but his immune system works in wrong direction. What do I mean by immune system working in wrong direction? Like say pollens, grass pollen, or a dust mite dander, dog, cat, whatever, even food allergen. As a human immune system, our immune system is supposed to tolerate them. Our immune system is supposed to accept them. It should not react with that. But similarly, our immune system should react to typhoid, malaria, dengue, whatever the bacteria infection comes to our body. That's what is immune system's job, to protect us from what is harmful, to not to fight against something which is not harmful to us. So this is how normal immune system works. But in an allergy patient, the difference is the immune system fights against infections. But immune system also fights against certain dust mites or pollen. That's the wrong direction, the reason why the patient is suffering. If the same person who is allergic, the dust mite enters his nose, it triggers off a reaction, inflammation. And the result of that inflammation is what is a sneezing, block, or itching, or leaking. If that reaction is happening in the chest, it causes wheezing, cough, phlegm. The same thing is in an allergic person, it is there, but it doesn't bother him. Because the immune system doesn't even touch that. We don't react to that. We are friendly to each other. That's the difference. So please understand that a person who is allergic is not that is low immunity, is that immune system is slightly working in a wrong direction. Okay? So when we test the allergy for nose and chest, we don't involve food allergy. We involve what we breathe. And that includes dust mites. In an Indian scenario, on a rough data, there are like hundreds of research articles. Some research has said that 60, some research has said 80. 80% of the allergies are due to dust mites. I'll show you what is dust mites. Even in my practice, when I do a skin prick test or a blood test, we end up seeing that most of the times we have a dust mite positive. Second comes pollens, molds, the fungus and molds, insects. Insects means what we are talking about is a cockroach dander. Cockroach is there, but cockroach saliva, cockroach dander, which is left out on the ground and floor, is what is a symptom or trigger factor. Animal dander, cat, dog, all those things. This is what we commonly include, and this is what we get a useful benefit when we test it. This is a dust mite. This is a dust mite. Okay? So the size of it is around 6 to 8 microns. Okay, that means nearly, if we take millimeter and divide 1000 times, it is like 6 parts of it. Insects, as we told, cockroach. This is a dog or cat. When we talk about pollens, we talk about three groups of it. What grows on the ground is called grass pollen. What grows up to like 3-4 feet is a wheat pollen. What grows a bigger, taller than us, or 7-8-10 feet is a tree pollen. So the most commonest one is the grass pollens. There are several types of grasses, but most common for Indian scenario is a Cynodon dactylon called, it's called Bermuda grass also. This is something which, even if you go down below, you will have it. But now we have all varieties of grass in India, thanks to the movement of people getting import-export, we have all types of grass pollens. When it comes to weeds, these are the medical names, but I'm sure all of you would have seen these plants. This is called as a Congress plant or Parthenium, and this is called in Telugu it's called Pupukura kind of a stuff, and this is spiny pigweed, which is again very common ones, something which everybody of us know in this. So usually the pollens which causes allergy doesn't have a beautiful flowers, doesn't have a good looking plant, it's usually the not so good looking, because the pollens, these not so good looking plants, they release their pollens to the air. The good looking flowers, all those things, they're the pollination. One pollen goes to another plant is by the insects. But what is ugly looking, where insects don't go there, so pollination can't happen, so they release it to the air. Even one pollen stack can release millions together. There is a lot of condition for doing a skin prick test. The patient should not be taking 1 week of certain allergy medicines like cold cough syrups or medications. Skin has to be healthy. If skin is having any rashes or anything, we can't do. So put a drop of allergen, make a prick so that it goes inside the skin. The prick is not painful, it's only 1 millimeter. We do it for 6 months, 1 year old child, when there are food allergies, they don't cry. And 15 minutes later, wherever the drop, wherever you have pricked it, the pricking is because you are allowing the drop to go inside the skin so that it communicates with the immune system. If the patient is allergic, then they will develop a rash of around 5, 6, 8 millimeters. Another method of doing is called blood testing, immunocamp testing. As I told, certain conditions where you can't do a prick test. There are, like, as I told, skin has to be healthy, patient has to avoid certain allergy medicines. There are some patients who even reducing 1-2 days of medicine becomes a difficulty. Okay, and so in that condition, what we do, we go for a blood test. So blood testing can be done in anybody who, even if they are taking medications, we can do. Skin condition is not good, we can do. And the other advantage of the blood test is, we have a lot more varieties of testing. In skin test, we have a limitation. We can do around, say, 15-20 allergens, because only that many are available in India. What we call as a standardized allergens. There are hundreds of skin prick test material, but they're not standardized. The standardized ones are something which are imported, and they have a highest quality kind. The blood test, we have a nearly 250-300 kind of an allergens can be tested. Another advantage of blood test is it uses a quantitative. Like, if your 0.1 is a cutoff, how high is your allergy? 5, 10, 15, 20. So the quantitative value also adds up to the treatment. So now, regarding more of an allergy testing, I think Dr. Samrat will be speaking. I will be continuing my talk on, okay, we did an allergy test, so what? How is it going to change the treatment? How is it going to be different? See, for example, I will tell you, this is something like, okay, we identified dust mite, and there is something called dust mite proof allergo cover, where the threads of the dust mite cover is woven at 1 micron distance. That's something which can completely cover your mattress and pillow. That reduces the contact of dust mite with the skin and reduces the symptom medication scoring. 46% decrease in the symptoms as well as amount of medicines what was needed.
But that will remain there.
That will remain there. That will remain on the bed, on the mattress. So another thing is, okay, you identified as a cat. Avoiding the cat was able to reduce the symptom scoring, nasal congestion, rhinorrhea and itching. So identification of specific, where I am coming up to is, don't do blanket avoidance. Avoidance of identifying and specific avoidance is what makes a difference. So okay, I am doing avoiding, is there any cure? I spoke about immunotherapy, which, as I told, may not be 100% cure, but it is nearer to the cure. Yes. Like, one group of patients were treated only with medicines. They were not treated, like, they were treated with nasal spray, they were treated with inhalation medicines, not with immunotherapy. Another group of patients were treated with medications plus an immunotherapy. The difference what was seen was, at the end of 1 year, 30.03% of the patients were requiring less of a medicines, less of a steroids and everything. By 2 years, immunotherapy is a 3-year course. 54.5 by 3 years, 60.6% of the patients were not requiring any of the pharmacotherapy. Pharmacotherapy means, I'm talking about the medicines, inhalation, everything. So this is something which you can make a difference only after identifying the right allergen. So till now I have spoken about nose allergy, chest allergy, what could be the possible causes, how do we treat? We don't channelize only on medicines. We channelize on all other possible, including non-medical therapy, including the exercise, and avoidant, identifying of the allergen, and then avoidance of the allergen, and taking it to the immunotherapy. Do you have any doubts now? You want to ask any questions?
A nasal allergy problem. My granddaughter has 3 to 4 symptoms of that.
Yes, ma'am.
She gets nasal block, can't. Every month, colds, cough, or severe cough, and she was using a nebulizer also. So next, what should I do?
How old is your daughter?
Granddaughter is 6.5 years old.
6.5 years. Okay. So now here, the situation is, 6.5 year old child getting frequent cold cough. Okay, and does she also have a leaky nose frequently?
It starts with leaky nose and end up with a first dry cough and then wet cough.
Then severe. Does she sneeze every day?
Not every day. My daughter has allergic to dust.
So that's a family history there.
And my granddaughter's grandfather uses sometimes nebulizer.
So there is a family history. So one thing which matches. What I want to know is your granddaughter. We talk about your granddaughter. 6.5 years. So how frequently does she sneezes? Maybe every day morning, twice in a week, or once in a month, or?
I don't know exactly, but from last 3 months, every month she is getting a cough, cold, frequently she is getting
okay.
it.
Okay. Does she keep rubbing her nose or anything?
No, nozzle block is too much. When she talks,
does she snore in the night time?
She snores sometimes, but when she speaks, you can make out she has severe nozzle block.
Voice changes there.
Uh-huh.
So what do we understand? A 6.5-year-old child getting frequent cold cough, most of the symptoms are in and around the nose, either leak, block, okay, occasionally sneeze is there. There is a strong family history. And now when this cold becomes so much, it goes to the chest. The cough is a symptom of a chest, mostly I'm talking about. Okay? When it becomes little more, it goes to the chest, and as madam was telling, it goes to the need of nebulization or anything.
Yeah.
Okay. So now this patient, this child, how would I work it? Yes, pharmacotherapy has been going on, it's been doing. Now we need something to identify the root cause. We need to identify what are the trigger factors for this child. And once we identify trigger factors, then after identifying particular trigger factors, we see how to reduce those trigger factors. And if this child is having some allergen which are specific, like a dust mite or a pollens or anything, we may consider immunotherapy. Parallelly, the many other things, whether the nutrition level is all right, whether vitamin D is all right, whether the child's activity, exercise level, how is the child's surrounding? Is the child outdoor, child indoor? How does the child spend most of the time? These are many factors. As I showed you in the graph, six things were how we handle the therapy.
Behavior problem, she's little underweight.
Yes, ma'am. So second point, what I would like to tell is, as madam says, most of it fits to allergy, but we, as a doctor, we always so-called, we keep differential diagnosis. What is differential diagnosis? For this symptom, this is a likely diagnosis, but number two is one more diagnosis which may be possible. There is something called adenoids, where there is a structure behind the nose, like a tonsil in the throat, adenoids behind the nose, which usually causes blockade of the air passage. Those children have frequent cold cough. Those children are snoring in the night time. So we, as a doctor, we never say, this is the diagnosis, I am 100% sure, nothing to worry, all those things. We always have a one possible top-end diagnosis, second diagnosis probable, third diagnosis. And we, all our investigations are designed and planned in such a way. Okay? Okay. This is why number one I am considering, I will evaluate number one. If I am proved, I am wrong in number one, then I will evaluate number two. I won't do 20 investigation at the same time. That is wrong when a doctor, wrong on ethics, wrong when the patient knows. That's the process what we follow. So it looks like madam is talking about an allergic condition. So what we would like to do is, we would like to follow this step, ma'am. First is, I would like to understand that.
Even my husband has dust allergy. It runs in the family.
It runs in the family, yeah. So we will look into this. We will optimize the medical therapy. What do we mean by optimize the medical therapy is, first thing is, I want my child, my patient to be comfortable. Then I'll work up later. So first thing I would start on this child would be a nasal spray, okay, which will usually given around 2-3 months. It does contain a micro dose of steroid. But I would like to emphasize to the crowd, please don't get panicky when the word steroid is used. Either somebody tells you or somebody don't tell you, I'm giving it, don't get panicky. Why I'm telling you this thing is, all of our body produces steroid. If we don't produce steroid, we are not alive. Okay. Currently, the luckiest thing is, we have a technology of sense in a safety limit. That when it is given into the nose, the allergic inflammation will settle down significantly to an extent of 90-95%. And the medicine designs actually only microgram goes into the nose. Third, with the technology, what has been done is, what is given to the nose is only around 0.05% gets into the blood. It doesn't get absorbed into the body much. In that way, though it's a steroid, it is microdose and itself doesn't get absorbed. The sad part is, if you take syrup as a steroid, tablet as a steroid, that's where the danger comes. The reason is, those things are all in milligrams. And when we take it in a syrup and tablet form, all the medicine gets absorbed into the body. Because what goes into the stomach has to get absorbed, otherwise how will it work? What is applied here, it has to work only here, it should not get absorbed. That is why it is made non-absorbable. What is goes to the stomach is made absorbed. So first thing is, I will control the child's symptom, make her comfortable, understand the history, and probably I would, since she is getting frequent nebulization, I would stop her on nebulization and go for a short course of inhaler. Okay? Why you are asking me is, because inhaler has got the same medicine as your nebulization, but again 1,000 times lesser dose. To take an example, one nebulization what you take contains 2.5 milligram of medicine, which is 2500 microgram. One nebulization. One inhaler contains 100 microgram. Why would I give 2500 when I can achieve a control in 100 microgram? Okay? So I would reduce the medicines what they are taking, but put it in a planned fashion so that my patient is not only controlled at that present symptom and also stop this recurrent episodes. Okay? So this is something which I get immediate control. After that, once I do that test and see avoidance, and then put her into some kind of a non-medical measures and everything. Observe the child, how the child is doing. The child is doing extremely well. I'm happy, okay, after some, usually in summer they don't get symptoms. We reduce and stop. In peak winter, medicines are needed. If my patient is doing very well, I'll stop it here. But if my patient is not doing well in spite of all these things, then probably I will have to go for immunotherapy, which has got around nearly not only benefit, long-term benefit, and I can get away using my medicines in the long term. Okay? So shall I go on to food allergy?
Yes, sir.
Please stop me if I'm taking too much time.
No,
sir. This is something very, very common. Okay, food related symptoms. I have not put food allergy because allergy is one part of food related symptoms. So now, avoidance of food is something which is believed and then followed very strongly. I feel that this causes a problem to my child, so I will avoid it very strongly. If your neighbor tells it, then you will avoid much more strongly. If my doctor tells it, you will avoid much, much, much more strongly. Okay? But when it comes to evidence-based, it is weakly followed. Okay? Now coming on to the food allergy, whether is it an allergy, whether is it a food poisoning, whether is it intolerance, is something which we have to identify. Yes, food has caused symptoms. It is not necessary, it has to cause allergy symptoms. So what we do is, something has gone wrong with the food. Whether it is immune mediated is allergy mediated. As I told, allergy is nothing but immunity system working in wrong direction. It is allergy mediated. Right? It is non-allergy mediated. It is toxic. Toxic means food poisoning or eating the food with unclean hands or something. Tomorrow, day after tomorrow, your child has got loose motions and vomiting or anything. That's toxic related. This is something where hygiene and cleanliness will solve the problem. So we'll talk about these two things. So when it comes to allergy related, there are different types of food allergy. Certain food allergy are so dangerous, even a half a peanut can be life threatening and dangerous, can cause even dangerous complication to the extent of catastrophe. Okay? So that is one variety. Another variety, after getting exposed to the allergy, there is a symptoms of vomiting, diarrhea, rashes, swelling of the lips, swelling of the tongue. That's something a second. Then another variety is there where I eat food, I don't have any symptom, but next day the patient has got a bloody diarrhea or vomiting, stomach pain, cramps, that kind of a symptoms. So food allergy is categorized as IgE mediated. Don't bother about this IgE at all. It is something which happens immediately, and this is something which happens delayed process, like probably after 24-48 hours, these two. What is this food intolerance is something which we need to understand. Now, what is food allergy, what is not food allergy?
simply telling about it, food allergy is immune mediated. Even the smallest dose causes a reaction, and the reaction usually starts at the place where it enters. Now, allergy is something which triggers the response where it comes in contact. For example, if I'm allergic to a watch, that metal, I have a rash on that area. I don't have a rash here. So it starts in that area. Allergy causes symptoms where it comes in contact. That is why the nose allergy, chest allergy, we test only allergens in the air. We don't test the food allergens. So usually allergy starts off with that, but once it gets into the food allergy, goes to the stomach and gets into the blood, then you can see the reaction in the vomiting, diarrhea, then rashes, and if it becomes too severe, it can cause drowsy unconsciousness. So that's how the character of an allergic presents it. And symptom can even occur, if you touch a milk and touch a skin, some child can develop a rash. Okay, so it can even occur with the contact, even smell also, and all modes of the body parts are involved. What is non-allergy is usually intolerance. Intolerance means, for example, we commonly call it as a milk intolerance. Another example is, if a child has got loose motions for 1 week, your doctor tells, avoid milk for some days. Okay, your child is lactose intolerant now. The meaning of that is, that's not milk allergy. What is happening is, milk digestion to happen, there is something, an enzyme called lactase is needed. Because of diarrhea, that enzyme is not producing adequate manner, or destroyed, or cells are destroyed. So if you give a rest for 1 week, the enzymes again starts producing, and then you can digest the milk. So that is a temporary process. That means your digestion is affected because of diarrhea, because that enzyme is not produced. So 1 week, 10 days, you avoid milk. That's a lactose intolerance. Okay. There are certain things you would have spoken about, actually. Gluten, wheat-related problems, gluten-related problems. So though it is immune mediated, it is not an allergy mediated. They work in a totally different fashion about it. So, and in intolerance, what happens? If you take a small quantity, nothing goes wrong. The more and more you take, the more and more symptoms. And usually symptoms are restricted to the stomach and intestine. An intolerance patient will never have a rashes on the skin, because it is not digested, it comes out either vomiting or it comes out as diarrhea. Only it is digested, goes to the blood, only it can cause symptoms. So it goes out like that. So most of the symptoms are restricted to the tummy and related. Allergy is something which can happen anywhere, head to toe. You know, a person can become unconscious, person can have a rash, anything. So when a patient comes up with saying that I have this symptom because of this food, what we generally tell is, okay, when did you have this food? After how many minutes or hours you had a symptom? Because allergy means immediate allergy happens within 2 hours, 3 hours. Okay? So you had these symptoms. What are the symptoms you have? Can you elaborate it? Did you have this food in the past and you never had any symptom? Yes, doctor, I've been drinking milk and I've been eating eggs and I don't have, but this time I had it. It is very unlikely to be an allergy. I've been tolerating this, then how could you go about? It is possible, but it's very rare. So it is very unlikely to be an allergic process about it. Okay? Then the type of symptoms. Based on this, we categorize it is immediate mediated allergy, it is a delayed mediated allergy, or it is not an allergy, it is an intolerance. So we categorize, and then we see, okay, which one needs to be tested, which one need not be tested. So these are something which causes immediate reactions. And these are something which can cause, these are allergy mediated. This one can cause a delayed reaction. This I already spoke. Lactose intolerance, fructose intolerance. Now, this one I want to speak. Certain foods, they have that character, inbuilt nature, like bananas, we can say, or like a spinach, or tomato, cherry, strawberry, citrus fruits. They contain one component called histamine. Okay? These foods release histamine. Histamine is something which can cause little itchiness. Okay, and sometimes a little irritation, sometimes little one or two sneezes. It is not an allergy, it is something which is the symptom. When will this citrus, when will this food will cause a symptom is, if a patient's original allergy is not controlled, and then giving these fruits might make you feel that, okay, symptoms have gone up a little bit. That's a momentary process. Please understand that is not allergy. That's because the food itself is like that. The same child, same patient, when we control food allergy completely, control the nose allergy, chest allergy, and eat lots of this tomatoes and cherries, nothing will go wrong. To make you understand, I'll give you an example. Put a perfume on your skin. Nothing will go wrong. Nothing will happen. Put a perfume on the wound. Put a perfume on a wound. It will burn. Why was it burning now and why was it not burning before? The protection is gone. When you have a nose allergy, throat allergy, chest allergy, a lot of inflammation, the protective layer is gone. And that's the reason whatever can irritate is irritating. Coming back to this, people tell dust allergy. When I go, there is a lot of dust, I get sneezing. When I'm cooking, that smell causes allergy to me. The reality is they are not allergens. We don't even test them. We don't test the road dust, construction dust, we don't test the fumes. Because they are not allergens, they are irritants. Okay, let me differentiate. Allergens means they can cause your problem, provided the patient is allergic. Irritants means they can't cause your problem, they can worsen the existing problem. The perfume worsened, the pain worsened, burning worsened because there was a wound. Okay? The dust allergy made a patient to sneeze because he is already inflamed inside and it went and irritated that cells, that's all. The same patient, when he controls full allergy, he goes to dust and he goes to do everything, nothing will happen. Because now his layer is well protected. Understood the difference between allergen and an irritant? Okay? Irritant is not the root cause, it is a worsening factor because the patient's protection is gone. Allergen is something, his immune system is working in wrong direction, it can make them cause the symptoms. Okay? So, talking about skin allergy, food allergy, anybody wants to ask me anything? Food allergy doesn't cause asthma. This one. Food allergy doesn't cause asthma. How is it linked? Is it is IgE and non-IgE mediated disorders. It is not the causation factor. It can food allergy and asthma can coexist. Like a person is having example I will tell her. Father is having asthma. Okay. Child doesn't have asthma. Child has got only food allergy. Child has grown 10 years, 15 years, child is still allergic to peanut, but he doesn't have asthma. What is mean is there is a genetic linking, there are associations. It is not like food causes asthma. The same pair, the child who is having the peanut allergy is not having asthma. If he eats peanut because he is having allergy, he can have wheezing as an allergic reaction to that. If he doesn't eat peanut, he doesn't have asthma. There is not a direct causation. As a food allergy, patient is allergic to that particular food, he is having genetic tendency, that means he is still has got his DNA, has got like allergic DNA. Okay, the trigger is always there. But as of now, he doesn't have any asthma symptoms. He doesn't cough, he doesn't breathe, he can run on 5 kilometers. But he is allergic to peanut. Only if he eats peanut, it goes bad, he can't breathe, his rashes flare up, everything shows up.
Once there is a reaction, that could cause the asthma.
Yes. It's a reaction process.
Doctor, so continuing, two things I want to find out.
Yes.
Early morning, after the baby wakes up, it feels like the vomiting sensation is there. Or after seeing his breakfast, before having the breakfast, or when he is having his first piece in his mouth, immediately it feels like vomiting. Does it have the food allergy or the other?
He vomits or vomiting sensation is
like
only vomiting or he is coughing and vomiting.
Only
there is no coughing, there is no cold, nothing out there. So as soon as he wakes up, he has got a vomiting sensation. And
yes,
when he sees food, even if without seeing food also he has got that vomiting sensation.
He's having.
So this is something totally different, not related to that. Because is having only to the food, then we can say possibly food. But you are saying that every morning he's got this vomiting sensation, nausea sensation. When he sees food, it may be give you more, or
the
symptoms are more. This is definitely not a food allergy. There's something which I can't say this is a diagnosis which probably needs to be worked up. Okay, maybe a gastro person has to see that, but definitely not a food allergy. Food allergy will happen after eating food. There are some food allergy which smell also can cause it, but that will be only particular food. For example, fish. Only when person allergic to the fish, only when the fish or fish smell comes, he will have a reaction. But he can eat chicken, he can eat curd rice, nothing will happen. So allergies are specific. That particular protein is there, then only it will cause.
That early morning vomiting sensation, does it have any relevance?
As I told you, there is some reason for it which I can't see. Probably I have to completely understand the scenario. And if I can't, then probably I will put up as a gastro person to understand why is this nauseating trigger for it. And that way, if it is an early morning, it's difficult to explain. Okay, I will talk about skin allergy. In skin allergy, there are two conditions which we commonly speak. One is called eczema. Eczema is something, a common term is considered as extreme dry skin. Okay, dry skin with rashes coming in the elbow region, rashes coming in the behind the knee joint, and for children it comes on the face, comes on the tummy, based on the severity. For some people it can be very mild, some people it can be throughout the body everywhere. Okay. So that's called atopic eczema. It's a severe form of dry skin. In fact, this atopic eczema, food allergy, or rather allergic rhinitis, nose allergy, asthma, there is something called as allergic march or atopic march, which I would, if you can go and read more about it. What is this allergic march or atopic march is? Family has gotten allergies. In a child, how will it shows up? Usually, the first thing, food allergy may or may not be. Skin allergy will be the first one to show. 3 years, 4 years later, the child has got a frequent cold cough condition. 7 years, 8 years later, continuous nose sneezing and everything. By 10 years, the child gets into an asthmatic state. So this one allergy starts with skin allergy, comes to the chest allergy, nose allergy, and asthma. Is something called, it's a march line, march past line. So that's called as allergic march or atopic march. That says that they are carrying those DNA. It is expressing at different stages of life. So these two are something which is common. Okay, urticaria is something which usually children or adults they come up with. They have these big rashes. After 2-3 hours it disappears, and again after some 8-10 hours it comes up. Extremely itchy. After some hours again it can disappear. And sometimes it is so much that if they scratch on their hand, the mark comes up. These are the two conditions which are commonly seen. Now coming on to the food allergy as a skin symptoms. This atopic eczema, dry skin, there is 35% of those children. That means if 100 children have this eczema, 35% of moderate to severe eczema children have a food as a worsening factor. I mean, they already have a disease. They eat that food. For example, we'll take it as a milk and egg. They already have the skin allergy. When they are eating this milk and egg, the skin allergy becomes more. It becomes more worse. So that is a trigger factor. So again, coming back to this condition, identification and avoidance can decrease severity. Unnecessary avoidance of many things will result in undernutrition. Food allergy rarely causes urticaria. The below picture which I showed you, this picture is a rarely because of the food allergy. Only 2% of it is associated. Okay? The person at 25 years, when they get these rashes, he comes to me saying that I'm avoiding this 10 and I'm still getting the rash. 25 years you have been eating all these things and you got this rash, and why are you leaving the food for it? They eat everything. It may not be. This is though urticaria, it comes on the skin, it is itchy. The most of these urticarias are either infection triggered, viral infection triggered, some chronic urticaria, they are either spontaneous or autoimmune process. Let us not discuss too much, but what I can say is food is a rare cause So unnecessary avoiding is not useful. And all these patients with urticaria, though the patient comes to I will say, I will not test you, it is useless, eat all this food, nothing will happen.
What about this one, Dr. Oily food also, such as also treating this? Is it possible.
For example, okay, when we talk about allergy, the concept, even when we test about allergy, now everything revolves around the protein component in that particular food. Say about peanut, we'll take groundnut. Peanut means groundnut. The allergy is because of the groundnut protein, not the carbohydrate in the groundnut, not the fat in the groundnut. It is the protein component of it. They talk about allergy. When we test in the lab or test in the skin prick test, they're actually testing the protein component of it. The reason is fats don't cause allergy. Fats can make you cholesterol, all those stuff. Fats don't cause allergy. Carbohydrate allergy is 1 in a billion chances. There are reported, but they are 1 in a billion chances. Okay? So we don't do that. When it comes to the oil, it's mostly the fat component of it. But during the extraction process, see the groundnut extraction process, you can have a slight amount of protein into that. So if a patient says, I'm using groundnut oil, I'm using sunflower oil, or I'm using olive oil, and every time I use that, I have this symptom. If I don't use it, I don't have this symptom. Then yes, they will test for the groundnut protein. We are not testing the fat, we are testing for that. They will certify you test no, and based on that. There are many times, I'll tell you about the next level of testing also. There are many times after the testing also, we are not very sure. What happens is, my patient is sure, I am allergic to groundnut, doctor. My report says normal. But I always respect patient, not the report, not the paper. What we do in that scenario is, we take them to the next level called OFC, Oral Food Challenge. What is this Oral Food Challenge? We analyze the risk, okay? In Oral Food Challenge, we actually give a food to them. If it's a peanut, we actually give them a peanut. There is a flow, there is a structure of doing that. We start with just a smearing on the tongue, and then probably 0.5 gram of it, and 1 gram, 10 gram of peanut. We do that in our clinic or in the hospital. If the risk is very less, then I do it in my clinic. If the risk is more, then I do it in Manipal Hospital. We keep the patient for 8 to 10 hours. We actually give them the peanut at a graded, starting from just as I told you, smearing. We go up to 5 gram, 10 gram, 15 gram, 20 gram of peanut. And after giving it, we observe them for next 8 to 10 hours. We see that, okay, no reaction happens. Then we say, see, you are feeling that it is a food, a groundnut allergy, but Oral Food Challenge is negative. That means you can take. I'm certifying you, go, please eat groundnut, don't worry about it. Okay, because there is nothing as gold standard as OFC. Real life scenario. Okay, you can't have anything else beyond that. Okay. I'll find out. This is my last.
Sorry, one just last question. My son had the same scenario that he was diagnosed for acute urticaria, Yeah, and then he had the symptoms like picture which you showed, the fourth one, the bottom fourth one. And initially they said it was hives, and then they said it's maybe through a food allergy or some insect bite. Then they did all sorts of tests and they couldn't come to any conclusion what was it. My question is, they said it's an acute urticaria, so we are worried whether is it repeatable, like is it gets repeated or...
No, the urticaria has resolved.
Yeah, it was just 2 months ago and it was for a week and it's gone.
The meaning of acute urticaria is, once the rashes come, if it resolves within the first 6 weeks, it's called acute urticaria. If it goes beyond 6 weeks, it's called chronic urticaria. We have patients for 2-3 years, 5 years, continuously getting rashes. That's called chronic urticaria. In acute urticaria, 80 to 85% of this acute urticaria, the cause is triggered by the virus. Usually, 1 week, either during or 1 week prior, child has got some kind of cold, cough, vomiting, diarrhea, some kind of an infection. During the fag end of the infection or something, the rashes comes up. Rashes takes 1 or 2 weeks or 3 weeks, then it subsides. This is how the acute urticaria mostly presents. White reaction is again another possibility, okay, which again takes around scenario, which I see not as dangerous. We don't have to worry this. But what is the information we get from this? This child's immune system is likely to deviate its path when it is triggered. You may get it, may not also. Nobody's going to predict it. You may get it. But bottom line answer is, don't worry about it. Don't even go to the doctor. Just use that same cetirizine or allegra, same thing would have given. Use it for a week, 10 days. 99% will settle down. If it doesn't settle down, that's called angioedema. Usually, urticaria, 50% of the urticaria can go with angioedema. Angioedema means swelling of a body part. Swelling on the lips, swelling on the eyelids, swelling on the throat body. Swelling of the tongue, change in the voice of the child. That's something risky, dangerous. Internal swellings are different. They have a different condition causes. And for that, even in first visit, we work up, but we don't work up allergy. We work up certain complement mediated disorders. The other segment itself, that's a pretty vast one. But if this swelling on the external side with urticaria, as I told you, use for 1 week, most of the time it's but most of the time the trigger is only viral. Maybe because of the viral fever reason, you have to visit a doctor. Or say urticaria goes away. Most likely, ma. I think when chapnatla, I have manual condition yemi. ఏం జరుగుతుంది ఎంత మాత్రం కండిషన్ పాస్ట్ అవుతుంది అండర్స్టాండ్ చేసుకునాలి అన్లెస్ మనము పేషెంట్ని కంప్లీట్గా అండర్స్టాండ్ చేసుకొని పేషెంట్ని చూసి ఎవాల్యుయేట్ చేస్తే కానీ ఊరికి ఊరికి పాల్గొని చెప్పలేము మనం ఎవాల్యుయేట్ దెన్ టేక్ అ డెసిషన్ ఇప్పటి వరకు మీరు చెప్పిన దాన్ని బట్టి నేను ఏం చేయగలను అని చెప్పాను కానీ బట్ పేషెంట్ చూసి ఎవాల్యుయేట్ చేసే వరకు నేను 100% ఇలాగే అని చెప్పలేను గుడ్ టు స్పీక్ ఇన్ మదర్ టంగ్ Okay, this is my last slide. 6-year-old girl, this is a real situation, this is not imaginary. After eating a cake, 20 minutes later, child fell down unconscious. Okay, there are some children here, I'll make it more lighter. Unconscious, feet scalded, went to the nearest hospital. 15 minutes later, the child was given nebulizations, medication, everything. And child was referred to a next hospital, but in the process, something terribly went wrong. Okay, so this is what happened. It's a birthday party, and parents know that my child is egg allergic, and family asked people, and they told it's egg allergic. So this is what happened. Why I'm giving this scenario is this can also happen. We should our brain should be like wide. We should like 360 degree, we should think. We can't be focused on one thing. So, the problem what went wrong was this child was allergic to the egg and the immediate type variety. Severe within few minutes to hours. And within few minutes to hours, the child had a very severe problem ending up with catastrophe. So, this kind of an allergy is something called anaphylaxis. Anaphylaxis means life-threatening allergy. This is something when we suspect about food allergy, we always do the testing, analyze, grade the severity. Like somebody tells food allergy from me, I'll tell the same answer what I told to mother. Yeah, food allergy, avoid it, but let me understand. If it is something which is causing you stomach pain tomorrow, then I would say once in a while getting exposed is okay. If something which is causing immediate reaction, then we not only say avoid it, but we train the parents, patients, everybody to how to handle that situation in that minute of time. There is some injection called EpiPen. Okay? That injection is something life-saving injection given immediate reaction can be life-saving. So those level of allergies are there. Those level of allergies is best identified, proven, and you can't cure that. Egg allergy is there. I can't give, nobody can give any medicine to say that I will cure the egg allergy. Something which you need to avoid for lifetime, avoid it. Okay, that requires a lot of education, knowledge, parent involvement, child involvement. Okay, ABC step one, if it happens, what to do, where to go to nearest. This is something that precaution, prevention is what is life-saving, no treatment is life-saving. Okay?
For eye checkup, because he was having little reddish eyes, watery eyes. So we went for a multi-specialty hospital, and three hospitals we went. They gave steroids for 15 days, one hospital. And after, within 8 months, the other doctor also gave a steroids dose. They told there is a dust allergy or something allergy is there. It was reduced, but it was not removed. Then still, we were in my hometown and there was nothing, no problem with that. When we came back, again he is having the same problem. And now, after seeing your presentation, I feel that it is because of this cough cold or something like that. Connected to that, I think so. Because he is sometimes snore also, a little bit, not much. His voice also changed. Little bit hard it comes now. And that allergy is again, and because of that, he rubs his eyes, and little bit of power is there. So we went for four hospitals, you can say, and some said that no need to wear glasses, some said we need to wear glasses, but he is not at all comfortable to wear that glass. So we don't know how to handle that. That is an eye allergy or it's a breathing allergy. We are not.
Coming back to, does he have frequent cold?
No.
That is sneeze regularly?
No.
Only snores regularly?
Little bit, sometimes, like after, you can say in 3 months, sometimes the cough cold will be there and then chest condition little bit.
Once in 3 months?
Yeah. My husband is having dust allergy.
Sneezes?
Not, he doesn't sneeze, but if he drive by bike or something, then he have a cough cold and he will have fever. So doctor told it's a dust allergy.
From the child's perspective, is it mostly from the eye?
Yeah, it's literally for the right eye and nothing else.
Not for the left eye?
No, left eye is okay. Right eye only every time it will be little red sometimes.
Right eye is okay or zero?
No, some power is there.
I'm not asking about power.
When it increases in right eyes, after I think 15, 20 or 1 month, she will say that it's also happening in left eye.
No nose, no chest, no wheezing.
Now he is having cough cold, so after 3 months it comes, so it's like
his eye symptoms are regularly, chest symptoms are once in 2 days.
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay, this is something which again we commonly see. Okay.
And one more thing, doctor. He is having congenital hypothyroidism, but doctor says that it is not related to
it. It's not related directly, definitely not. See, now when we talk about the eye allergy, dust allergy. Dust allergy causing an eye symptom. Why is the dust allergy sparing the nose? Why is the dust allergy sparing the throat? Why is the dust allergy sparing the chest? Because dust which is coming in front of me, it doesn't know. I should avoid the nose, I should go only to the eye. Does it know?
When we are breathing something, how can something go into the eye without going into the nose, without going into the throat, without going into the chest, without going? Happen. See, many conditions are labeled as allergy, but they're not allergy. Okay.
Now, for example, I showed you that urticaria, which has been labeled as allergy. Went for an allergy test and everything, didn't matter much about it. Anything which causes rash, anything which causes itching is labeled as allergy. But there are many, many, many conditions which is not allergy, but labeled as allergy.
For the common man's term, but see many things, I'll give an example, asthma, childhood asthma.
Child is using nebulization almost most of the times, child is using inhaler,
but if a word told by doctor that your child is having asthma, the patient doesn't come to the doctor. Reality, okay, let us be truthful to all of us. The child is having bronchitis, child is having dust allergy, okay, he's having recurrent viral infection. That parent will accept it. The moment parent is told your child is having asthma, he will not accept it. But parent is using the same medicine for asthma, but they don't want to accept it. So I always tell my patients, front ahead of it. Accept it or not accept it, treatment is not going to change. By accepting it, not only medical therapy, a lot more can be done. Can be done avoidance, can be done non-medical therapy, we can reduce the medicines. Reality, ground reality is very important. Okay, let's be clear with that. 10 out of 9 patients, they understand, they come back. One patient doesn't come back, fine. They'll find a comfortable pediatrician somewhere else. Okay. So, whatever your child's symptoms are telling, it is an immune-mediated reaction which is happening in the eyes, but it's not dust allergy related. The reason is, there is an allergic conjunctivitis, okay, which should have cold, leak, sneezing, itching, because the component which is reaching the eye has to go inside the nose, has to go inside the throat, it has to create a reaction. If it is causing only eye symptom, it is an autoimmune disease, okay, which generally, the way the symptoms are telling, usually starts up in boys, 3 to 4 year old children, usually peaks, that means it becomes more worse around 7 to 8 year old children, and gradually it subsides. By around 10-11 years, it disappears completely. This is actually an autoimmune mediated disease. It is not an allergic disease. No matter what allergy test you do, it may not come out. If a patient, same child, would have a regular cold, regular sneezing, okay, regular wheezing. Regular means not necessarily every day, at least weekly, twice or thrice. Then the same allergen which is causing the nose and throat is also causing the eye symptom. That's the patient we will be benefited with allergy test. That's the patient we will be benefited with whatever the immunotherapy, avoidance, everything. This is pure eye related. Rubbing. Yes, when you keep on causing the eye, you actually damage your cornea. Okay? And the cylindrical shape, everything changes, the power increases, everything. So that's something which an eye-related disease, not an allergy-related disease, but it is labeled, it is spoken, it is told as an allergy, but truly categorizing it doesn't come under allergy, it comes under an autoimmune disease. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, sir, for an informative and lively session. Now I would like invite Ms. Aishwarya to hand over a token of appreciation to Dr. Bajaj. Thank you so much, Dr. Okay. Our next session is from our own pathologist, Dr. Pradeep, who will provide you a brief guide to our child's immune system.
Hi.
Hi.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So I'm here to just brief you about what we are always healthy most of the time. So the reason why we are healthy is here. So is Sunday the most happiest day? How many of you say yes?
The kids agree.
But why?
No school.
Huh? With regard to children, why it's the happiest day?
No school.
No school.
But I'm actually getting you back. You might think why is he? He's actually speaking about immune system, or he's speaking about school. Now, we'll just get a scenario that your child has to enter the school now. So that's a mission now we have. So the child has to enter the school. So there are always challenges that exist in this. So there are a few barriers that would always exist. What it might be? If the child has to enter the school, what would be the barrier that would always exist? Wonderful. Compound?
Yes.
Then? Logs, whatever. Now, there are always some other barriers also, which might not look like a barrier, but it is still. For that security to allow you it.
Time.
Time. Which form is this? So what would they actually tell when? Just before this? No. What does it tell?
He explains that.
All is well.
No, we came because of science.
Why do they actually enter the wedding? And how do they enter the wedding?
To eat.
Mm. And he says, uniform like that. So these are the barriers. As I said, yes, ID card is one more thing. So I'm still speaking about immune system. So let's take it one by one again back. So barriers that exist, what have we said? The building, gates, locks and things. Now, who's this? What is he doing? So your tears, whatever that comes out of your body, is actually protecting you from so many infections. And now?
Happy.
What are you able to see? So in your mouth there is some secretions which again protect you from so many infections. So likewise, those barriers which are there, our body has barriers in its own way. Now, what color is this? So what do you remember when it's red?
Danger.
Okay. Then any things if you can speak of?
Blood.
Then?
Paint.
Huh?
Paint.
Yes. Okay. Actually, I wanted to answer that itself. That's good. So why am I speaking about blood now? I mean, blood, it's made of the water and some cells. Basically, this is the basic. Now, which of these would help our body to be very immune?
White cells.
Wonderful. So, we told about the barriers that are in addition. Security. Exactly how your white blood cells act. So, in that you have types of white blood cells. So, these are the ones which are in addition. And these cells will go and fight those microorganisms and all, and they'll kick them out of the body. And this is one more thing, like which we spoke, that barriers which do not look like that, but this is not so important for us. We'll let you know later. So we'll just slightly alter that mission, the same, but we'll transcribe it, where the body has to get rid of infection or anything which is equivalent to that. So your body surface itself is one barrier, then the white blood cells, and there is a pattern recognition process. So any harm to this above components will actually result in infection to our body. Okay, so then what is it?
Bad white doctor.
Okay. Now, have you ever scolded your kid that because of this ice cream you got cold this week?
Yes.
Have you got scolded also?
Yes.
Yeah. So that means like you are blaming it on something else, the fever or something which has come. You are blaming it on something else. So but then, I am thinking something about a primary immunodeficiency. That means the body, the components in the body itself have gone wrong. So that's the basic definition from Oxford Dictionary. It says of the principal thing, the first thing that itself is wrong. So this is a letter which was there in internet. So about the primary immunodeficiency, that means the children keep getting infections, but they don't know actually why these are coming, and there might not be a reason. But has any of your pediatricians told that no, it's just the kid and all kids get sick? That is fine to an extent, but if they are getting sick often, that's when we have to think of something like primary immunodeficiency. So there is a group for this primary immunodeficiency, and they say so there are 10 warning signs that they explain about recognizing this primary immunodeficiencies. So these are the ones. So this is what I want you all to focus on. So if your child is getting more than 4 ear infections per year, because ear is something very much inside, so it's very tough for a microorganism to go there, sit and make that infection happen. And then sinus infections, which are more than 2 in 1 year, and then more than 2 months treatment with antibiotics, but till the child is sick. And more than 2 pneumonias, that is lung infections in a year. Then if there is any insufficient weight gain, the child is not putting on weight. And then there are recurrent deep skin infections that happen. And also, if at all the child has persistent infections in the mouth, and then if at all it needs antibiotics, which has to be put in form of injections and not through oral. And then again, deep seated infection, something like the meningitis, which is more of the brain cover, which is getting infected. And as Dr. Parachandra was telling, there might be a family history that has actually hooked on to this immunodeficiency. So if the child is getting sick very often, that's when we want you to look at a pediatrician who is specialized in immunology. So there you might get an answer. So how would a lab would help in such things? So we know that if the child gets sick, we are going to this doctor, and this is when we have to suspect immunodeficiency. So how a lab can help in that perspective? So we all spoke about white blood cells. So the counts, complete blood counts, where we would see the white blood cells. So there might be increase in few cells like the neutrophils, or there is a decrease in the particular cells like lymphocytes, or let's say the counts are all normal. They are there in a proper quantity, but they are not functioning at all. So such tests are done. So then there are few things like few other tests which we do regarding lymphocytes. There are types of these cells which are there that can be assessed, and that will give a hint that this is primary immunodeficiency. And then you assess immunoglobulin. So what kids actually like? If they are outside school on a Sunday.
Ice creams, chocolates.
Leave about the intervals.
Play.
So coincidentally, immunoglobulins are GAME. Okay. Those are types of immunoglobulins. Yeah. And about neutrophils, we have these neutrophils will actually powder this organisms that are entering and they digest it. So for that also we have a test which would actually diagnose that there is a defect in these functions. So you might say, okay, I went to the doctor, we got the test also done, but if at all my child is still falling sick, is it treatable? That's the main concern. Is it treatable? So yes, it's definitely treatable, but it's like we have to prevent the infections, or we need to eliminate whatever the fever that is there presently, or if there is a defect in that immunoglobulins, we can give them injectables, which are immunoglobulins. And then if there is that defect in the neutrophils to fight, then we have to go for a marrow transplantation where we replace the entire number of cells and the marrow will start producing new ones. So this is what I was telling about pattern recognition. This is not so important, but why I actually put this, well, let's say there is this Republic Day program in the school and your kid is asked to face the paint and get to school. Now you think the security can actually recognize which school kid he is?
No.
No, right. Now look at this kid. Which movie? So he has actually done well to get into the school. As we spoke, that mission to enter the school is actually entered. But he's been kicked out. That means your immune system is actually going in the wrong way. What Dr. Balachandra Bhatt was saying, it's your immune system itself, but it is going in the wrong direction. So that is happening here. So your immune system actually protects you also, but makes something bad like this. Or something like this where they actually have entered, but they're getting punished or something like this. So immune system has different phase. So it actually protects us also, but when we are over smart, when it becomes over smart, it might happen in other ways also. So is your child immune deficient? Still don't know. So this is about the immune deficiency foundation, but are you knowledgeable about immune deficiency now? Okay. So, gratitude to my colleagues and Anand for giving me this opportunity, and gratitude for our own immune system which has kept us healthy all through this. Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pradeep, for simplifying such complex topic. Now we are open for any questions.
There is, Cipla has these immuno boosters. Are they helpful for the kids? Because I want one box of it for my kids and I don't know how far is it helpful for them.
I would say, like, it will definitely help in a way, like a mental booster, probably.
Mental booster.
Kind of a placebo effect. But then, like, have your kids fallen sick anytime so bad that they require frequent hospitalization?
No, they just run with cold and cough here and there, but nothing hospitalized or something like that. Just cold and cough, they often have this running rose or something. Cough in the night, and that's how.
So anything if you are giving like immune booster is always good. That always keeps the child in a good health. But if they are not requiring any hospitalization for those cold and coughs, it's absolutely fine.
Any more questions?
What kind of test should we get done from sinus?
Sinus, it depends actually, like if it's like, who is getting it now? What's the problem, if I have to ask?
Running nose.
Yeah.
It's my daughter.
How often?
It depends. It starts in the rainy season till the winter. Summer, she's fine.
So that's more of season. It's not kind of infective then. It's more related to probably something like allergy or the seasonal variation.
Is there any test that I have to get done?
I think Dr. Samrat would be able to help you with that.
We are going to speak in about that in the session.
Okay, thank you.
So my son is of 2.5 years and he often feels sick. What would be the problem?
How often? Which kind of infections does he get?
Why don't we go out of station when he comes back, he feels sick. Cold, cough.
I would still say that's more related. But I would tell that get to a pediatrician and probably yes to an immunologist or even a.
Is it necessary to do any blood tests?
No, if you can go to these doctors who are specialized in that, they would be able to take a call on whether he actually requires tests for this. Because if he is falling sick every 2 months, that's when he would say that yes, he might require a few tests. And
Once he walks, once he runs, he picks up
his weight. That's what I told you. He's just a kid, and that's not a diagnosis. It might be still an immunodeficiency. So, always like get to a pediatrician, yes, but who is specialized more in immunology. Just have an opinion. It's just to ask him whether is it actually that or is this yes, kid itself.
Any more questions? Now I would request Ms. Aishwarya to hand over the token of appreciation to Dr. Pradeep.
Thank you for a fun session.
Now, our final speaker for the day is again one of our own pathologists, Dr. Samrat, who is keenly focused on diagnosis. Support in allergy care.
Good afternoon, everyone. A lot of energy because it's lunchtime. I thought everyone would be like hungry. Anyways, we had two sessions now where we discussed so many things. So my idea of this session was to something to do with diagnostics, in the sense, you know the problems now. Now, how to go about knowing exactly what problem it is. See, when you have a problem, from your questions, you want to know the solution, right? But if you don't know exactly what the problem is, you will never find the right solution. Only when we know exactly what is the problem, then you get the correct solution. So the whole idea of diagnostics is to identify the problem. My topic was, what is the role of diagnostics in allergy care? It's not only in allergy care, in all aspects of medical science, we have to identify the problem, and that is the role of diagnostics. When we speak of tests, what tests to do, when to do, how to do, everything boils down to one fact, that we are trying to identify the problem so that doctors like Dr. Balachandra and other doctors, clinicians, can give you the correct treatment. Only then the problem will be solved. So I will limit my talk to allergy diagnosis, but some of the rules which I am telling, which I'll speak about, applies to all aspects of your disease state. Can be allergy, it can be an infection, it can be something else. But these kind of rules apply to all. So in allergy, what is the need? We all know, like most of you, when you're telling, no, my child is allergic, my child is that. When you speak of allergy, Dr. Balachandra, you know, he touched upon this. There are three A's of allergy which we should be aware of. The first one is the atopy, the second one is allergy, and third is anaphylaxis. Okay, what do these things mean? These are nothing but they are a continuous spectrum. When we talk about atopy, allergy, and anaphylaxis, what we mean is our body has genes, when he spoke, which makes us susceptible to some kind of allergy, or when Dr. Pradeep spoke of immune deficiency or something. But we have the genes, doesn't mean that we have the disease. Allergy is the disease, the form when we see a child having runny nose or itching or whatever. That is the disease form of it. So you have the genes and you have the disease. When the disease is at its severest, the end spectrum, then we have something called anaphylaxis. So why diagnostics is important in allergy care? Of course, to know if your child is allergic or not, but to avoid anaphylaxis. So, and this anaphylaxis is only related to food. So when you have a food allergy, it is very, very, very important to know what is the allergy, what is the culprit, to avoid a serious event. I think Dr. Balachandra spoke about it in his last slide, where a very unfortunate accident happened. So that is why it is important. If it is symptoms are mild, they will grow out of it. But to be aware of it is very important. Dr. Pradeep spoke about it, Dr. Balachandra spoke about it. In context of allergy, little bit of a background on what is the mechanism, why it is important. Because if we know what is the mechanism, why it is happening, then we will know what to test. Okay? So you have these genes, susceptible genes in your body, which makes you kind of, you know, no, we are all not same. My five fingers are not same. Me and Dhruva don't have hair. Some people have a lot of hair. All these boil down to genes, you know. So you have some genes, and they, in allergy context, they produce something called IgE. Dr. Pradeep spoke about immunoglobulins in his previous discussion. So, and he told that it is game, G-A-M-E. So the E part of it, that is the culprit in allergy. So when you have susceptible genes, your body tends to produce these IgE, immunoglobulins, which are very specific to that particular culprit in large amounts. And when your body produces this IgE in large amounts, they go and sit on some types of cells which are called mast cells. These are again part of the immune system. They go and sit on it and they wait. They wait for what? They wait for the culprit, the allergen, the pollen, the dust, whatever you can. So if I am not susceptible to it, my body won't produce the IgE. That will be not sitting on the mast cell. And when I breathe the pollen, I don't have any reaction. But a child or an adult who's prone to allergy will be producing these, and they will be sitting on these. So what happens then when you come in contact with the culprit, the pollen or the dust or the food? These go and sit on those IgE molecules, and the cells break and release all these different chemicals into the blood, out of which the most important one is called histamine. If you see your medications, what you take for allergy, the most common ones will be antihistaminics, means they stop the histamine from working. So histamine, as he told, that some foods produce histamine. Our body, these cells, they store this histamine in the body. It has some useful effects also, but when they start breaking up because of the pollens which sit on them, and they release in large amounts, they cause all these symptoms. So histamine is the major, major player which causes all the symptoms of allergy. You take runny nose, you take itching, you take rashes, all these things are, histamine is one of the most important players in that. So now we know what happens, right, in allergy. So what do we detect? What can we detect in diagnosing an allergy? We can detect the susceptible genes, correct? I can do a genetic testing and say, okay, this person is susceptible to allergy, this person is not. We can detect the IgE in the blood, which will be much more at a higher level than people who are not allergic. We can actually detect the reaction itself happening. So which one of these you think is going to be most useful? Do we detect the genes, do we detect the reaction, or do we detect IgE? Actually, all of these play a role in some point. When you are trying to see if a patient or if a person is allergic or not, then we detect the reaction and the IgE depends on the condition. I'll tell you how it is done and in what, which condition we should test what. But the susceptible genes still, they haven't picked up as yet in testing modality. Only because you may be susceptible doesn't mean that you have a disease. The meaning is, I may have a gene. If I do a genetic testing, I will have 10 types, different types of gene. But that gene translating to a disease, there are a lot of other factors which play a role. So directly testing for a gene and telling that you may be allergic, you may not be allergic, doesn't make any sense until and unless the reaction is happening. I showed you my first slide, right? Atopy, allergy, and then anaphylaxis. Atopy means we are susceptible. May not be that we are having a reaction. We may not be allergy, a reaction may not be happening, but we are susceptible. So I think if you do a genetic testing, out of 10, if 6 people are susceptible to allergy, only 3 actually develop an allergy. So we don't need unnecessary testing and unnecessary treatment for anything which we may not develop our whole life. So there are a lot of mechanisms how genes operate. Some show, some don't. Next, we now know what we can detect. We can detect the genes, which is not very significant. We can detect IgE, and then we can detect the allergic reaction. When we are doing the skin test, which Dr. Balachandra spoke about, we are detecting the reaction in the body. Okay? When you are doing blood test, then we are detecting the IgE in the blood. This is the basic difference between a blood test and a skin test. In skin test, you are evoking a reaction in the person who is susceptible by introducing that allergen to it in small amounts in the skin. And you are seeing whether it is reacting or not. And in blood, you're taking the blood out and seeing in the blood whether that IgE molecule is in high levels or not. So there are different ways to do the skin test. I think I won't go too much into details, but it's a Dr. Balachandra, he already spoke. But basically, it's what it does is you small amount of the, I mean, if you're suspecting 10 allergens, those 10 small allergen amounts will be introduced into the skin in different ways. You can do it by a prick or a scratch, or you can even do it as a patch. After that, within 15 minutes, if you are allergic, they will see if a reaction is there to that particular thing. If it is there, then you are positive. If it is not there, then you are negative. That's all they do in the skin test. But this skin test is a very specialized way of testing. Why? Because you are introducing the allergen to the body. Means that you are putting someone and knowingly giving that allergen to someone. So it has to be done under very controlled condition. It has to be done by a specialist who is trained in that in a hospital setup. Takes about 15 minutes to do the test, and in case you have any medications like what I spoke about, antihistaminics, most common ones, that medication you have to stop for a period of 7 days minimum before doing the test. Why? Because we are testing the reaction. What is the most common compound which causes the reaction? Histamine. So we cannot take antihistaminics and expect the reaction to show up on the test. Okay? That's why we have to stop the medication. There is a very, 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 very small chance that it might lead to a very serious anaphylactic reaction. That's why we need to do it in a hospital setup. And there will be doctors who will be monitoring the test. And if by chance that reaction happens, you will get medication to immediately stop it. Okay? The second type of tests which we can do other blood tests. So these IgE molecules, they will be floating around in your blood. We draw the blood, then take the blood and put it into small wells which we have in our lab. Okay, what these wells are, these are, see, coated with the individual wells will be coated with 1111 allergen, one well for one allergen. So if your body is producing IgEs to a particular type of allergen, those will go and get stuck to the well, and then we can detect them by different methods. So the one which we use here is called a immunocap method. Immunocap is one of the methods of detecting IgE in the blood, and they have kind of standardized the way how to detect it. So we are using this wells to detect. So these are the two types of testing methods which we can do. One is the skin test and one is the blood test. The skin test, as I told you, can be done by a specialist, and this is a... But when you come to blood test, I think Dr. Balachandra mentioned it, that the skin test has only 10 or 15 or 20 standardized components which you can test. The blood has 200, 300. It's like... my mother tongue is Assamese, so I have a saying in Assamese that when you have too many choices, you become blind. How do you know what to test, where to test, how to test? It's easy when you go to a clinician and he chooses it for you. But from our experience, we know many a times before going to a clinician, parents would themselves come to a testing facility and would want to get something tested. Or their clinicians would have told, please go and do an allergy test. They would come to a different place, and then everyone would struggle to know what test do we really want. So this next part of my talk is trying to give you an idea what blood tests are, what are the different meanings of the different terminologies we use when we do a blood test. So little give you a little bit of idea on that. First, when we talk of blood tests, there are two types of tests which are available throughout. Something called a screening test and something called a specific test. There are two photographs here. What does this look like? The security check in the airport, correct? And what this looks like? Some people are going into a house, police house. When a security check happens, it happens for everyone who is flying. Correct? What do they try to do? They try to screen everyone if they are carrying any firearms or anything. They don't have any specific information that this person is doing or that person is doing. It's for everyone who wants to go and fly on an aircraft. They have to go through the security check. So even in testing, when we talk about screening test, it is to screen everyone. Not everyone, but anyone who wants to come, they don't know. There is no suspicion as such for a particular allergy or anything, but just to know whether we are allergic or not allergic. Okay? When a person knows that the child is allergic, or a doctor knows that the child is allergic, and he has a suspicion list of say 5 or 10 culprits, then we go for the specific test. Like the police, they have information that this is a suspect who's staying in this house. They will send specific people to go and target that. They will not go and search the whole neighborhood like that. So that is the difference between specific tests and screening tests. The second type of terminologies which are going around with tests are qualitative and quantitative tests. Okay? Both the pictures One person is tall and one person is short. This is, on the left side, is a qualitative. A person is short, a person is tall, we can make out, but we don't know by how much. Sorry. The second one is what we call the quantitative. We know exactly by how much the person is taller than the other person. Why this is important? I will show you one case from our own experience. The difference, how does this make a difference? Where will it make a difference? So it is something like this. One person is saying, I am correct. But it's only by 5% that you are correct. Doesn't mean that you are absolutely correct. Something like that. So that is the difference between a quantitative and a qualitative test. So this is the next thing. Why quantitative and qualitative tests actually make a difference? If you see this, we have three things which are positive on the left side. If you notice here, similarly, the same three things are also positive. This is a qualitative test and that is a quantitative test. Do you notice any difference between the two? Both are positive for chicken and dust mites. Any difference? Anything? Yeah, of course there is a value, but anything do you notice? If you see, this qualitative test is giving you positive, positive, positive. You are positive for chicken, you are positive for dust, you are positive for dust mites, correct? But if you see the quantitative test, for chicken it is only 1.65, but for dust it is more than 100. Okay, this is where it plays a role. Now, when Dr. Balachandra was talking about immunotherapy, when you want to target a specific allergen for which it is causing, in immunotherapy, it is always important to target the one which has the highest level of your antibody in the blood. Your qualitative test is fine. I'm not telling it is not fine, but your quantitative test gives you the exact picture. You may be chicken, you may be dust, and you may be this, but your problems are 99% caused by the things where your blood levels have the highest IgE levels against. Like for this, in this case, dust mites are his major problem. Chicken is not. He may think, oh, dust mites are everywhere. What do I do? I will stop avoiding chicken from now. He'll avoid chicken, no problem, but his symptoms will never get cured because the major problem is the dust mite. This is where qualitative and quantitative tests make a difference, a lot of difference. And when you go for specific therapies like immunotherapy, you have to know exact level of antibody in your blood for them to start the therapy. Yeah, the dose and medications will depend on your antibody level in the blood. A clinician, but very difficult for a parent when their child is having a problem to identify the problem. It's a very simple algorithm, if you can remember. Is it allergy? First question is that. Whenever any symptoms are happening, is it allergy or is it not allergy? You have two answers to that. Either it will be a yes or it will be a no. If it is a yes, we would want to know who are the culprits which are causing that allergy. And if it is no, what is the other possibility that the patient, the child is having these problems, correct? Is it allergy or not will be told to you by the screening test. If yes, the culprits will be detected by the specific test, and if it is no, then we have to undergo other investigations. The first slide, if you remember, the problem and the solution, you have to correctly identify the problem. If we go by this way of thinking, we most likely 99% chance we will identify the problem. But if you go from down, if you do a specific test first, then go around, we may not find the problem and we will be wasting a lot of money, effort, and and with a child it's a lot of emotion, because we don't want to draw blood every time from our child. It's a very difficult task to do. So this way of thinking, it's not only for the doctors, it's for everyone, every parent. Please think of it in a logical way. Ask the correct questions, you will get the right answers. So examples, little bit examples of the screening tests, what we are doing. So we have Fadia top and a screening panel. And then we have specific tests for respiratory allergies and specific tests for food allergies. The idea behind the allergy testing is not to test for everything. Okay, you have 200 tests, we cannot start testing. It'll be very easy, right? Take a blood and test for all 200 allergens. The most thing, the thing which inhibits us from doing this is the cost. It will be very, very costly. Second thing, it doesn't make any sense. Okay? So it's always better to go by the algorithm. Do a screening test if you don't know if it is allergy or not. And if you are sure that it's allergy, if you want to find a culprit, then do a specific test based on his symptoms. This is where Dr. Balachandra is very helpful, or any pediatrician for that matter. When he was asking you, right? When is the child is sneezing? Is he sneezing very often? All these things help him to decide what type of allergen might be culprit. And then he will choose specific panels for that. Okay? So we should not be like this, where we are seeing the tail and it's a rope, we are seeing the body and it's a wall, we are seeing the tusk and it's a fork. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Samrat, for saying such key insights to allergy care. If you have any questions, you can ask. Questions? Now I would request Ms. Aishwarya to hand over a token of appreciation.
Thank you,
to Dr. Zahir.
I think that sums up the entire. Thank you. And feedback.
I would like to spare another 5 minutes for you guys. We will be giving you the feedback forms, and please fill the feedback forms. And we have come to the end of the session. I would like to thank each one of you for being patient, hearing, and active participation in making this event a successful one. And we request you to fill the feedback form and hand it over to the printers. Thank you.